All right, so if you've been hanging out with me in any of my online classes or training workshops, you've heard me hammering this point home. Learn your tools. The deeper, the more you know your tools, the better you're going to be. Now, the little trick in this example, it's a prime example of what I mean by learn your tools. All right, so take a look at the screen here and I'll show you what I mean. Okay, so if you look at the screen, the interaction really is taking place down here. I've got this network attached storage. We're trying to calculate how much storage this can hold based on the capacities of each of the drives. So you could say, you know, we only need one drive if only one drive goes into each slot. But we actually need up to four drives, because what if the learner only has 4 1-terabyte drives, right? So the question is, how do we create multiple versions of this drive without having to duplicate the drive 4, 5, 6, 7 times, or maybe resetting the slide, jumping back to the slide each time it's dropped on to reset the position of the objects. All right, we've got a few different paths we could go down for setting this up, and each one's got its own set of trade-offs to consider. Let's go ahead and take a look at how it works. So here's what we'll do. I'm gonna jump into my practice file. And so the idea is, as we drop this on, we need, I'll just put that above, I guess, we want to reset this back to the beginning. And so the easiest way to do this is to work with a motion path. So I'm just going to grab the motion path and I'll say align. So it's going from here to there. And then we'll say my path options will go from left to right. So we can reset the motion path each time an object is dropped or something else happens. We can say return, right? Reset that path. Or play the animation. So right now, by default, the animation starts on drag cube when the timeline starts. And delete that trigger altogether and then add a new trigger. And let's say move that motion path. So move the cube along the motion path 1 when the object of the cube, so the object is dropped on. So we're going to say we drop that target, that cube on the target. Go ahead and play that animation. All right, so here's the foundation of it. We'll see right here. So preview. It's not going to give us quite what we want, but it's the foundation of getting where we want to be. So nothing's going to play until this is dropped on the target. I drop it on the target, and then there goes the motion path. So the idea is, what if that motion path isn't the default length of 180 pixels, but instead, what if that motion path is only 0 pixels. So that's going to play that motion path. It's going to reset it right here back to the beginning. Now we also would want to change our duration too to the shortest duration we can do, which is 0.10. All right, so now we'll preview this real quick. And now we drag it on and look at that. There's another one and another one and another one. And because we are evaluating what's happening each time this is dropped on the target, we can have a variable. We can have a counter that counts each of the times this is dropped. We can make state changes. So for example, maybe we wanted to show a series of cubes being built up. You can click the states tab right here. You can see of normal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So if we wanted to simulate something like that with the cubes being progressively built, we're going to use a counter. So I'll create a new variable and we'll just call it counter. And we can make that obviously a number variable, and default value is 0. Okay. And let's put that reference here on the slide. So we'll say counter value, and then we'll add our variable reference. So insert tab, and then we want to pop open the reference, add the counter, the variable. And so that's just going to show us at any time what that current value is. And then because we now have that variable, that value, we can make things happen. So we'll say, what is this called? This is called cubes. We say, so the first thing we want to do is just adjust that counter value. So we'll say adjust variable, and we'll say not set, but we just want to add a value. So we'll say add a value of 1 to the counter each time the user drops the drag cube on the drop target. Okay, so that's all we'll do here to get this going. Now let's preview it once again. So at this point, there's no limitations, no conditions. It's just keep dropping it on the target, right? That oval target. Okay, cool. So now we can evaluate and make things happen based on that current value. And this is really back to, you know, Storyline sweet spot. So we could say when the variable of counter equals normal, you know, change this to zero, make it normal. And then when it's one, make it one. When it's two, and so on. So here we go with that. So now we'll just change the state. So we'll say change the state of our cubes to normal when variable changes of counter, if counter equals zero. I mean, we really don't need that since that's where it's starting, but I just like doing that. So now I'm just going to copy it. So copy and then paste a couple times. And then we'll just say cubes to the custom state of one when the value is one. Custom state of two when the value is two. Value three. I would just go four. All right. And let's do one more. I don't know if there's that many states, but that's what we have. Okay. So five, four, four, five, and five. Okay, let's preview this one. So we're going to count how many times it's dropped, and based on each drop, we'll change the state. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we could say, you know, once it's six, make this one now hidden, right? So we can say, finally, if we want this to disappear, I didn't do that on the capacity calculator, but we could say, yeah, you know what we'll do? We don't want to keep showing it once it's there. So let's say change the state of our drag cube to hidden, or we could say disabled, right? So that you can't drag it anymore. When the variable changes counter equals, we could just say equals a value of six, and then we could do it that way. All right, so one and two, go for the bottom, three and four and five, and right there, six. Oh, didn't drop it on there. Okay, so that's really it. I'm just gonna get out of there. But that's the idea, is that one pixel motion path is what's giving you that ability to reset an object. And then of course, with the variable, combined with the variable, we can change the state or the visibility of the object based on a specific value. Isn't that a nifty little trick? Once again, the better you know your tools, the more you master your tools, the more possibilities you will unlock as you advance in your skills and take on, say, more complex projects. You'll find that your software doesn't always have the exact features you need to solve problems, but that's okay, because when you really know how to use your tools inside and out, you'll discover solutions like this or other solutions or workarounds that help you meet your project's needs. Real quick, before we dive into the next lesson, let me quickly share a few examples that demonstrate this technique, the power of this technique, and just some different ways that you can use this zero pixel motion path. All right, let me pull these up. So this first example from Annabelle, kind of probably one of the best uses of this technique that I've ever seen. So let me pull up her example right here. So you can see I kind of used just a little bit of it with the cube building. But in this case, you're guessing how much sugar is in each of these drinks. You can toggle through different drinks, and then you've got the sugar cube right here. Now, this was a clever technique. I didn't show this when I was doing my demo, is that she has a second one, a last one that's right there. So this is the motion path example. And then there's another example right here to show that there's always one more cube, which is actually a really smart approach for it. But again, you're just guessing here. And I think you can keep going pretty far, and then you can check your answer and then see exactly how many sugar cubes are in there. But you always have that extra one on the slide to show that there's another one that you can pull from. And this is the example that I shared earlier. You can download the source file, take a look at what's going on, but essentially the same idea, but just in a different context here for measuring a capacity. Then I thought this example from Ron. Ron always does some interesting things and comes up with some neat ideas. But in this example, he's using it for, there it is. All right, let me pull up the review. He's using it for a drag and drop return to get hints, audio hints from the SME or the expert. All right, so let's play this real quick. I think I have to click through a couple screens, but I thought this was a nice take for how this would work. So we have to get through the intro here. Okay, so you have this action plan. He's setting up the scenario right here. What I like is each of these markers lets you hear from different people. And to get advice on where to drop each of these markers in the immediate, delayed, or the minor, you can drop them on the advice the advice guy right here,
if not
and
breathing,
hear from him, and then it returns the marker airway back to the position.
In this case, this
so each time I drop one of these characters
areas,
on there,
but is breathing well and has normal perfusion,
you get the
mental status is unimpaired.
The feedback.
So you tag yellow and move on. Obviously injured.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's a really neat approach to have a multiple drop targets trigger audio that plays and then still have the items return so you don't have all the items on top of the advice or the drop target wherever you're dropping those. Okay, so just a couple ideas for ways that you can use this technique. Hopefully you enjoyed it and find some ways that you can use this or a similar technique in your own e-learning projects.